as the continuation to the previous talk that you have watched, the next topic that we are going to discuss is how to linearize a function of two variables. Okay, first of all, let us see what do we mean by a linearization. You people have studied that any function f of x can be written as about some point. About x is equal to a, this function may be written as f of a plus f prime at a multiplied with x minus a upon 1 factorial plus f double prime at a upon 2 factorial multiplied with x minus a squared plus etc. So we can give such representation using a Taylor series, and this may be stopped till the order that we wish, right? If you consider only the one term till the first order derivative, that is the linearization of the given function about a given point. Okay, in this way we can linearize a function of two variables. Even if you want to linearize a function of three variables, yes, of course you can do it. First, initially let us see how to linearize a function of two variables. If you see here, this may in this diagram you are given some point. This is a general point which is near to x naught y naught. You may ask me, it is very far from x naught y naught, but you are saying it is very near to x naught y naught. We have a point x naught y naught here. Okay, we are choosing some point very near to this, and using a microscope kind of a thing, we are trying to see what is happening with this. Okay, so that is why we have drawn a diagram like this, and this is the point x naught y naught, and at this point only we are going to talk about the differentiability. Okay, from this point to this point, you can draw these vertical and horizontal lines so that this point would be what? Your x value is changed, that is x, and your y value remains y naught. So this is the line. So if you measure this distance, only this distance, it is going to be x minus x naught as the y naught value is fixed. So this quantity we represent as delta x. And similarly, if you measure the distance from this, if you measure this distance, it is going to be y minus y naught. Why are we making y minus y naught? Because y is up and y naught is down. So in order to get a positive quantity, we subtract this way, and this quantity we take it as delta y. Okay, and from the definition of a derivative of a two variable function, here I am saying derivative of a two variable function, I am not talking about the partial derivatives. Whenever I say derivative of a two variable function, it is something different from partial derivatives. Okay, hope we have seen that definition as well. That is f naught f prime at x naught y naught is going to be limit whatsoever f of x naught plus delta x comma y naught plus delta y minus f of x naught y naught, a combination of these quantities would be here at the denominator. Okay, and that quantity we will make to zero. So if you recall from the previous lecture, you can see what is the derivative of a two variable function. From that we are writing these things. Okay, here this epsilon 1 and epsilon 2 are some arbitrary quantities, and when you make your delta x and delta y goes to zero, that is if you choose your delta x and delta y to be a very small positive quantities, then your epsilon 1 and epsilon 2 goes to zero. So from this you approximate your f of xy as, you just take this to the other side, x naught y naught, then you have fx, that is the partial derivative of f with respect to x, evaluated at the point x naught y naught, multiplied with delta x, plus fy x naught y naught multiplied with delta y, and this epsilon 1 delta x plus epsilon 2 delta y. This means these terms may be written as order of delta x squared comma delta y squared. So I am writing this as like this. What does it mean? It means higher powers of these quantities will be present in the expression. What is delta x? Delta x is x minus x naught, that is from this diagram. right? And your delta y is y minus y naught. If you have only x power 1 and y power 1, that can be considered as a linear. But if you have x minus x naught squared, this becomes a quadratic term. So it is no more a linear. So that is why we omit, we neglect these quantities and take the rest of the terms as your f of y as a linearization. So the quantity on the left, on the right hand side is written as L of xy. And what we actually do is that we take this quantity as L of x, we take this quantity as L of xy, and this is the linear approximation of the given function. Okay, it is also called as standard linear approximation. So hope you got the idea. Now we are about to find the linearization of this problem. I don't know why is it happening like this. Okay, there are some issue with my pointer, so let me explain. Hope you can see the things. So here we are asked to linearize this function, okay, at the point 3, 2. If you have to linearize this function, what is the formula? If you recall from the thing that we have seen now, your f of xy is f of x naught comma y naught, then the partial derivative of f with respect to x evaluated at the point x naught y naught and multiplied with x minus x naught plus del f upon del y evaluated at the point x naught y naught multiplied with y minus y naught. So this was the linear approximation that we are looking for. So here you know what is your f, right? So from which, if you evaluate 3, 2, that is in the place of x, you'll have to substitute 3, and in the place of y, you'll have to substitute 2. That is going to be 3 square minus 3 multiplied with 2 plus half times of 2 squared plus 3. So it is 9 minus 6 plus 4 upon 2, which is 2 plus 3. So it is 14 minus 6, which is 8, right? Then we'll have to find out what is del f upon del x. So it is 2x minus y, and del f upon del y is minus x, and when you differentiate this term, you would get 2y upon 2, that is simply y. So your del f upon del x evaluated at the point 3, 2 is 2 times of 3 minus 2, which is 6 minus 2, that is 4. And your del f upon del y evaluated at the point 3, 2 is minus 3 plus 2, which turns to be minus 1. Okay, if you substitute all these values into the linearization, that is in L of xy, you may get the requirements. That is, your L of xy is f of x naught y naught, that is 8, plus 4 times of x minus x naught plus minus 1 times of y minus y naught. So if you multiply, what is your x naught and y naught? That is 3 and 2. So 4 times of x minus 3 plus minus 1 times of y minus 2. So it is 8 plus 4x minus 12 minus y plus 2. Therefore it is 4x minus y. So if you calculate these quantities, you are going to get minus 2. So that is your required linearization. Is the ideology clear to you people? Class, is the linearization concept clear? Okay. So moving further, when you linearize these things, there may be some error involved in it. That is, even for this, let me come to the one variable setup and explain you about the error ideologies. This entire expression is going to represent your f of x, but you are restricting with this alone. So these quantities you are neglecting. So these the difference between the linearization and the original function is called as the error. Okay, so that difference that we are going to speak here. So the error involved in it, in order to find the error involved in it, let us state what it is. F has a continuous first and second order partial derivatives throughout an open set, which means what? If you are given a function f of xy, you are able to identify del f upon del x, del f upon del y, and del 2 f upon del x2, del 2 f upon del y2, and del 2 f upon del x del y. Okay, all these are exist. Actually, del 2 f upon del y del x also exist, and they are equal to. Okay, that is the assumption that we make. It has a continuous first and second order partial derivative. So, all these derivatives exist, and they are also, all these quantities are continuous. So, this is the assumption that we make. Okay, in where? So, in an open set containing a rectangle centered at x0, y0. So, there is some open set that contains a rectangle centered at x0, y0. Okay, and if m is any upper bound for these functions, that is, if you are able to identify these second order derivatives, so look for the absolute value on this rectangle. Okay, then your error is given by this inequality. Okay, we are not supposed to find the error exactly, but the maximum range that the error can admit is given by this inequality. Okay, so here if you see, we are asked to find out the upper bound for the error in the approximation in the example 5. Okay, what was the example 5? The one that we have done now. So it is x squared minus y, xy. So the problem was f of xy was what? X squared minus xy plus 1 upon 2 times of y squared, and we had plus 3. Okay, the point was 3 comma 2, and what was our linear approximation? 4x minus y minus 2. This is the thing that we have done, and here we are asked to find out the error in this rectangle. So about this point we are finding, if you see what is this point, okay, 3 2, somewhere here this is our 3 2. So like this you are identifying some rectangle, and over this rectangle what is the error involved, that is what we are trying to identify. Okay, so these quantities you know for sure, and from this, okay, from the function f, we will have to identify the partial derivatives. That is del 2. Okay, first of all, what is del f upon del x? It is 2x minus y. And del f upon del y is minus x plus y. And del 2 f upon del x 2 is 2. And del 2 f upon del y 2 is what, 1, and del 2 f upon del x del y is minus 1. So now you will have to look for the absolute of these two quantities, that is absolute of f f x is 2 and absolute of f y y is 1, and absolute of f x y is also 1, that is absolute of minus 1, which is 1. So among this you will have to choose your m, which is the upper bound for these three values. Here we can choose our m to be equal to 2. Okay, if you choose your m to be equal to 2, then your error will satisfy this. That is, absolute of e of xy is less than or equals half times of m times of absolute of x0 minus x minus x0 plus absolute of y minus y0 whole squared. So you have this 1 upon 2, your m value is 2. And your x0, y0 is what? 3, 2. Okay, that is the function p0 that I said. That is x0, y0, which is 3, 2. So, if you plug these values in, you get this quantity. Okay, and your error is satisfying this quantity. And we know that this is less than or equals, you know, what is x minus 3? So, it is given by this rectangle, right? It is 0.1. So your absolute of x minus 3 is less than or equal 0.1. So you are going to have 0.1 plus, again this is 0.1, 0.1 squared. So that is going to be a 0.2 whole squared, that is 0.04. So if you convert this to a percentage, what you are getting as the percentage of f of 3 comma 2. Okay, we have identified f of 3 comma 2 as 8 in the previous problem itself. So how the 0.04, we'll have to calculate what is the percentage of the 0.04 in 8. So we do this calculation and we see that the error is 0.5%. Is the idea clear in calculating the error? Class?
Yes, sir.
Okay. The next concept is differentials. So what do we mean by a differential? That is, in one variable case, this is what we mean by a differential. What is the change happening in the function whenever there is a change happening in the independent variable? Okay, about a point. So the I have told you people many times that your dy upon dx is limit delta x approaches 0. Your y of x plus delta x minus y of x upon delta x. Okay, if you are about to evaluate this at some point a, instead of x you will have a here, a plus some quantity, and here you will have a. Okay, the quantity on the numerator, the quantity on the numerator is taken as delta y. If you write it as f, it is going to be delta f. Okay, that is your derivative means, derivative at any point means, that is limit delta x approaches 0 to the function delta y upon delta x. So this is what, so the one on the numerator is called as the differential. From this what we can see is that the differential may also be written as, if you take this delta x to the other side and write your limit delta x approaches 0 delta y, may be written as limit delta x approaches 0 your dy upon dx evaluated at the point x is equal to a multiplied with delta x. So we may write this way as well. So this quantity is becoming df. So that is what we have here. And this shall also be written as y prime evaluated at a. So with which we write the differential like this. And we are extending the same idea to the several variable case here. So your delta f is this quantity. So from which we'll have to write down the linearization. So we have taken the linearization. That linearization is written like this. So from which we see, this is the differential that we are talking for the two variable case. So with which we write the differentials. From differentials we are having the concept of total differential, which means if you are asked, if you have a function of xy, it means your total differential is df, which is del f upon del x multiplied with dx plus del f upon del y multiplied with dy. So we have seen it as the in the exact differential equations. Okay, while we have we were speaking about the concept of differential equations, we have seen some examples of this kind. And when we are given which is equal to some constant, that leads to the ideology of exact differential equations. So there we said it was exact. The same thing we are calling here as total differential. That's it. So with which we shall work out few problems. These are some application problems. Suppose that a cylindrical can is designed to have a radius of 1 inch and a height of 5 inch. But the radius and height are off by the amounts, which means there may be some change in the radius and height by these measurements. Now we will have to estimate the resulting absolute change in the total volume. Okay, instead of making a cylindrical can with 1 inch radius and 5 inch height, we have made it with 1.03 radius and 4.9 height. So we know the volume of the volume of a cylinder is given by pi r square h, right? We write the linearization. Okay, that is the total derivative. That is with respect to r, we'll differentiate on dr plus with respect to h and then dh. Okay, from the given. So this is the function of two variable case. Here, if you know, it is a function of r and h, because r and h can be any values. If you differentiate your v with respect to r, you are going to get 2 pi r h. And if you differentiate your v with respect to h, you are going to have pi r squared. So these are the derivatives. Now we will have to identify at the point what? So r naught h naught. What was our r naught h naught? It is 1 and 5. So 1 comma 5, which is going to be 2 pi 1 5, which is 10 pi. Okay, and vh is pi times of r is what? 1. So 1 squared, which is 1. And we have our dv as vr evaluated at the point with dr plus vh evaluated at the point the requirement r naught h naught and dh. Vr value is 10 pi and dr is 0.03 and vh is pi and dh is what? Minus 0.01. So this happens to be 0.3 pi minus 0.1 pi. I have written it as, yeah, so it is 0.1 pi. So the resultant is 0.2 pi. And approximately we know this pi is 3.14. So if you multiply it with 3.14, what you are getting is 0.63. Okay, you just do this and see you are getting 0. And this is the change in the volume. So here the measurements are given in inch, therefore the volume will be in inch cube. So inch cube, this is the change that would happen in the volume. So the next problem is, suppose you are working in some company, your company manufactures right circular cylindrical molasses storage tanks. You are making some tank with 25 feet height and radius 5 feet. Now you will have to check how sensitive are the tank's volumes to small variations in height and radius. Suppose you are a quality control engineer, means you will have to check these qualities, whether these products are made perfectly or not. Even if it is not made perfectly, how much the error can it admit? That is the thing that you have to check. Here, you are given with only this 25 feet and 5 feet and no other information is given. Okay, we know the volume of a cylinder can be represented as pi r square h. The total differential gives you this one. Okay, in the previous problem itself, we have seen pi r is equal to 2 pi r h and vh is equal to pi r square. If you substitute this 5 and 25 into it, so 5 and 25 means it becomes 125. 125 with 2, it is 250 pi. And this quantity is pi times of r is what? 5. So it is going to be 25 pi. So your dv is 250 times of pi dr plus 25 pi dh. Now let us see, if you make one unit change in the radius, what would happen? So your dr is going to be one unit. So your volume will change minimum of 250 pi units. And if there is a change in one unit in the height, it will contribute you 25 pi units. So comparing these two things, what you are getting? So you are getting 250 pi, which is a huge thing. So if you make your radius, if you make some changes in your radius, that affects the volume more. Okay, so if you take the other way around, so that is the conclusion that you have to say, you have to pay attention to the radius rather than the height. If there is some change in the height, that is not going to affect the volume of the cylinder very much. But if there is a change in the radius, it will affect very much. Suppose If you take the other way around, if you choose r to be 25 and h to be 5, then if a change in height will give you the more variation. Okay, that is explained in the rest of the part of this problem. Okay, so if you are clear with this idea, the same thing, instead of 5 for r, you are going to substitute 25 and h is 5 in the second case. The next is, this is again the same kind of a problem. We are given a volume of a right circular cylinder. Suppose r is measured with an error of 2%, which means till 2% error is accepted. Above it, it is not accepted. And similarly, height can be accepted till 0.5%, but not more than that. Okay. So, the error is given in terms of a percentage. Therefore, the error is calculated with respect to the radius. In percentage, it is given. So, it cannot be more than 2%. And similarly, height, the error in the height cannot be more than 0.5%. Now, if it is so, what is the maximum error that a volume can admit? Okay. From this V is equal to pi r square h, we can write dv is 2 pi r h multiplied with dr plus pi r squared multiplied with dh. Okay, we are given with this information and we are asked to calculate the error in the volume. So that is dv upon d. So we substitute what is dv and we substitute what is v. And this happens to be 2 pi r h dr upon pi r squared h plus pi r squared upon pi r squared h multiplied with dh. Here r and h gets cancelled, pi gets cancelled, and we are left with what? 2 times of dr, and in the denominator we have 1 r. Here pi r squared gets cancelled and we are left with dh upon h. So, I don't know why is it not writing. So, hope you can see see the things here. And so, this is, if you take the absolute value, it is going to be here. And using the triangle inequality, you can split these things up. And this one is, if you take this 100 to the other side, you would get it is 0.02, it is 0.005. So, substitute these values into it and you see the error, the maximum error that a volume can admit is 4.5%. Okay. And till now, we have seen several ideologies using the gradient vector and the directional derivative and the linearization, all those stuff we have seen. All these can be extended to functions of three variables and more variables as well. If you extend these ideas to three variables, what is the thing that you are going to get is given in this. That you can see in the linearization, you have one term extra, that is for z term. Also for the error estimate, you have one term extra, that is for the z term. And even in the total differential, you have the z term extra. So in this way, if you want to extend this to any number of variables, you can extend, and there is a problem based on three variable case. You can check these things. I leave this as an exercise to you people. That's it.